Shalom, everyone, and welcome to tonight's broadcast here at Passion for Truth Ministries. I'm Jim Staley. It is night 27 as we are counting down on the 29 days of the month of Elul, the 12th month on the Hebrew civil calendar. And we are moving towards the civil new year, which is called traditionally Rosh Hashanah, which simply means the head of the new year. The biblical term is Yom Teruah. That's the feast day that earmarks the beginning of the fall feast days that will, at some point in the future, mark the second return of the Messiah. And that's what we're looking forward to. So right now, it's heard that the king is in the field, and we are going out to meet him and prepare ourselves for that moment where he goes back into the palace, sits on his throne, and begins to judge his people. So I don't know about you, but my life isn't quite where it needs to be yet to be judged. I need to look inside, find out what's inside of Jim Staley's heart so that I can get it out and expose it and let God begin to cut off the rough corners of the edges of my life. And I hope that this series has done the same for you. After all, the entire intent and purpose of this series is to bring us to a place where we are looking more in his image. That 27 days earlier, by the time we get to Rosh Hashanah, a full month earlier, we were a different person, that we have been transformed by the renewing of our mind through the water of the word. And by the time that Yom Kippur gets here and that last trumpet is sounded, my friends, we will not be the same. We will be ready and prepared, first by the blood of Yeshua himself, and second, by our own deeds, that we have put aside the deeds of the flesh by the Spirit, and we've raised up the spirit man just a little bit higher this year. And that's what our goal is. So we've been talking a lot about the will to receive and how that operates in our life as a detriment that creates a deficit in our lives. And we've been talking about the characteristic of the Father, which is the will to bestow, which is to give to other people. So the will to receive that we have is designed so that we receive from him and we freely give to others. We support the kingdom work. We support the kingdom people. That's what we do as Hebrews, if you will, or people of God, or the way that the Father says it in the word, as Israel. So if you believe that you are part of the covenants of promise, then that includes the front of the book, the back of the book, the whole book. So help me, God. We are here to follow him and do Bible things in Bible ways. And tonight, we're going to move to a little different topic that's not really different. It's all connected, if you haven't seen already. And we're going to talk about holiness. What is the difference between holiness, godliness, and spirituality? There is a renewed spirituality in the earth today. Without a doubt, you can look at all the polls. Barna did a poll not too many years ago, and they're an organization, a Christian organization, that does polling about spiritual things. And they came to the conclusion that the church attendance is down over the last 10 years, but spirituality is up 20%. So spirituality is up, but church attendance is down. What does that look like? Can you be spiritual and not be holy? And can you be holy and not be spiritual? What's all this look like? I love my friend, Rabbi Shimon Jacobson, who wrote the book, 60 Days, A Spiritual Guide to the High Holy Days. He's got some good nuggets in there. And this is one of the nuggets that he gives. He says, godliness or holiness is not the same as spirituality. Spirituality can lead to holiness, but in itself is not holiness. And so I love that quote because it basically says that godliness is not the same as spirituality. And today we've really kind of taken the idea that if you're a spiritual person, you know, you've heard of people saying, I'm a spiritual person. I don't really go to church. I'm not really a believer in Christ, but I'm spiritual. Well, what that simply means is they believe that there is a higher deity. There's something bigger than themselves, and they're trying to get in touch with it. For a believer in Christ to say that I'm spiritual is not nearly the same as saying that I'm attempting to live my life in holiness. Godliness and holiness are different than spirituality. Spirituality can lead to holiness and godliness, but not always. does that happen, unfortunately. And so how do we define holiness? Because this is the underlying foundation of the entire scriptures and what the Father, through his Spirit, through his authors that wrote the word, we call the Word of God or the scriptures, is referring to is be holy, says I, because I am holy, says the Lord. Be holy because I am holy, says the Lord. What does it mean to be holy? So before we dive into that a little bit, I want to give just a couple more quotes of Rabbi Jacobson. He says this, unless spirituality is a path to holiness, it can be as egocentric as materialism. There are spiritual people who are quite arrogant. They see themselves as superior to everyone who is not as spiritual as they are. Holiness, on the other hand, demands humility. My friend, do you remember just last night what our topic was? It was on humility. And when I ran across this quote, it just validated that the Spirit is just brilliant in how he's unpacking this whole entire Elul series. He's moving us in order of the direction that he wants us to go. So we went from gentleness to casting our anxiety upon him, to love, to humility, and now to what? To holiness. That if we believe that we are superior to other people in our spirituality, oh, they're not as spiritual as I am, then you've moved away from holiness. Because holiness, as we're going to define in a moment, has nothing to do with arrogance or pride or setting yourself above anyone. As a matter of fact, would you agree with me that the Holy One, Yahweh, Jehovah, however it's supposed to be pronounced, at the end of the day, the creator of heaven and earth, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, would you agree that he's smarter than we are? That he's holier than we are? He is the holiest, smartest. If anyone had the right to be prideful and arrogant and set himself up above everyone else, it is him. But the Bible says that he came in the form of humanity, cloaked himself in humanity, did not think himself anything, but he brought himself low and gave his only begotten son for us so that we could be brought high. In other words, in order to bring someone else to a higher place, this is the scriptural pattern. Listen to what I'm about to say. We must go to a lower place. If you want to bring someone higher, you must first be willing to go lower and serve them. So wives, when you want your husband to be the spiritual head of the household and you want him to love you like Christ loved the church, you must first go under, not over. Husbands, if you want your wives to do the same and to love you and to be spiritual and so on and so forth, if you're trying to teach them something, go from underneath. It's the fastest way for our kids to learn is to serve them, because this is what Yeshua did for us. He came and he knew nothing but servanthood. That is how we become holy and we come set apart. So now let's talk about the actual word itself, kadosh. This is the Hebrew word for holy. It's kadosh, and it literally means to consecrate, to set apart, to prepare, or to appoint. You catch that? To consecrate, set apart, or to prepare. I think that's an amazing word that we've been talking about for 27 days straight now, is preparing to meet the Lord on Rosh Hashanah, right? Preparing. This is all about preparation of the soul, getting rid of the flesh and the will to receive and getting back to the will to bestow. And part of that is prepare. When you prepare, do you know what's happening? You're becoming holy. See, brother, sister, what you may not realize has been happening. If you've been following this series and you've been intentionally taking it serious as a course and watching it and rewatching it, taking notes and then implementing it into your life, you see, I'm not doing this just to stand up here and go through an amazing amount of work so that you can watch this and go, oh, that was really good, Pastor Jim. If you don't apply it to your life, then you're like the man who looks at himself in the mirror, forgets what he and says, oh, wow, he's a good looking guy, and then walks away, forgets what he sees. God is not looking for you to be a hearer of the word, but a doer of the word. So take these things that the Spirit is saying to you and implement them into your life. Be intentional about this, because when we prepare and we take an audit of our lives, we are becoming holy as he is holy. And I believe, especially if you've been understanding the front of the book and you can consider yourself someone who's trying to follow the Torah in the New Testament and put the whole Bible in context, we've been taught and you've been taught and that to be holy is to be set apart, and to be holy is to keep God's commandments. I'm here to tell you that that is not what holiness is. Holiness is not keeping the commandments of God only, ladies and gentlemen. God himself, Yahweh Sabaoth, does not need to keep commandments to be holy. He is holy. Holiness comes from inside of him. It exuberates out of him. It flows out from him like a spring. He is holiness. Our commandments that he gave us are designed to help us remove the skin and the flesh and the will to receive. It's the guardrails that are supposed to dig out the flesh so that we can reincorporate the pipe, reconnect the pipe so that the water can flow properly. You see, we get so excited when a single drop of water comes and we don't realize that the pipe is totally disconnected. It's barely hanging on. The commandments are designed to point us in the right direction. But holiness comes from the heart. Holiness is described as this. And we've talked about this so many times. But listen, it's described as love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. The fruits of the Spirit are the very, what's the word I'm thinking of? The fruit of the Spirit it's like the glitter on a diamond. It's the little sparkles on the diamond that say that this is a clear and perfect diamond. Without the sparkles, you have no sun, either have no sun or the diamond is so dull that it can't reflect the sun properly. Every facet of what God wants to do in your life revolves around this concept of holiness. And holiness revolves around the idea that we can be holy as he is holy if we understand that it's all about his image and it's the fruit of the Spirit. Let me quickly go through a few more scriptures before we end so you can get a context. 1 Peter 1, 15 through 16 says this, "But just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do. For it is written, be holy because I am holy." We've been talking about that scripture. How about this one? 2 Corinthians 7, 1. "Therefore, since we have these promises, dear friends, let us purify ourselves from everything that contaminates body and spirit, perfecting holiness out of reverence for God." What is this? We can contaminate our spirit and our body. We need to set aside the things that are of this world, the sexual immorality that is out of control, the homosexuality out of control. All of these different things that are invading our bodies and our minds and our spirits and everything about us that's polluting us, that's preventing us from hitting our full potential in Christ. God desires to deliver us from the bondage of our own sin and bring us to a higher level. He does that when we decide, you know what, I'm going to perfect holiness. And how am I going to do that? By working on ourselves. There's nothing in this scripture that's talking about I perfect holiness by perfecting other people. I perfect holiness by pointing out my brother's sin. No, you perfect holiness by purifying yourself, he says, from everything that contaminates your spirit and your body. Amen. How about one more, two more, in fact. Hebrews 12, 14 says, "Make every effort to live in peace with everyone and to be holy." Listen to what this says, my friends. Without holiness, no one will see the Lord. Brothers and sisters in Messiah, we need to listen to what the scriptures are saying. It says that we need to make every effort to live in peace with one another. Do you realize what that's saying? Make every effort. That means you don't stop. You do whatever it takes as if it's all dependent on you to make things right with your fellow man. especially those of the household of faith. And he connects that concept, that mindset, with holiness. To be holy is to make things right with people. It's to be at peace with people. My friends, you can't go into the fall feast days and be at odds with someone. You can't do it. It's forbidden in Scripture. This is the opportunity that we have to make things right, first with our King, then with ourselves, and then with other people. If you walk into the holy days with something undone, you're defrauding yourself of your own blessing, your own inheritance. You're trading for a bowl of soup. He says this, and by the way, when he says, be holy because I'm holy, this is what he did. This is what the Creator did. He came and dwelt among us to bring peace to us. That is the epitome of love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. It's the epitome of the fruit of the Spirit. Holiness is the image of God, and the image of God is peace. He wants to bring peace. If you don't have peace in your life right now, brother, ask the Father to give you peace right now. Pull over on the side of the road. Say, Father, forgive me for my arrogance. Forgive me for not moving in holiness and looking at my sin first. Forgive me for always pointing out my brother's sin, my wife's sin, my family's sin, my friend's sin. Ask the Father to open your own eyes to your own sin. That's what brings holiness, my friend. And listen what he says, no one will see the Lord without it. No one. Because when the sun sets, the only thing that matters to him is how close in the image of his Son are you. And I'll leave you with this, because we're out of time again. Psalm 139, 23 and 24 says this, search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offense in me, and lead me in the way of everlasting life. My friends, it is high time that we live a life that we say, God, search me. Don't search my neighbor. Don't search my spouse, my kids, my coworkers. Search me. I know you're going to judge me soon. So search me now. Better for God to search you now and show you your sin now so that you can repent than to show you on judgment day and you be utterly ashamed with no chance to make it right. Time is short, my friends. The only thing that matters is what did you do with the time that is short? I'm Jim Staley with Passion for Truth Ministries, and I encourage you, my friend, get on your knees before God right now, sometime soon. Tonight, let it be, and ask the Holy Spirit to search your heart and to show you any wicked way. It's my prayer that we all come to a place of unity and love and recognize that the image of the Creator is found in L-O-V-E. May it be found in you, and may it be found in me. Sure.